with Janaelle and Will.
Hello, everyone, and welcome back to Alternate Wind Condition. This is episode 17, and I am Janaelle, your host. With me is my, as always, is my co-host, Will.
How long is it till Shadows ever in a Strut again?
Not long enough.
Not long enough. God damn it.
Yeah.
All right,
so quick show news for everybody. I am house-sitting all the animals. So in this room with me are two hedgehogs, a cat, two dogs, and a bird. In this room, okay? So if you hear somebody getting a little cat fight, it's not my fault.
It's like, if all the animals start fighting all of a sudden, everything's fine. Don't worry about it. It should be fine, at least while we record this, and then, I don't know.
And Whisper the Dove is very excited, so you're going to hear her all show. There's also nothing I can do about that. She's just very excited. All right, so let's get down to brass tacks here. We have AskAWC. That's hashtag AskAWC, which you can ask us any question through Twitter. Jester, who I believe asked the two questions last episode, right?
He did. Yes, he did.
Haha, I remembered your name. That is a feat for me. So he asked us another question, and he says, do you double sleeve? Do you shuffle with a bridge, piles, or carefully fan? I double sleeve, but probably not how you're expecting. I don't double sleeve my cards. I double sleeve my sleeves. I have sleeve protectors. Because I give a shit more about my sleeves than I than my cards.
Okay, that makes sense. It's like, I don't know if I've actually seen sleeve protectors. That's a new one.
They're pretty cool. They've got, so you've got your sleeve, right? So the back, it's got some cool little picture.
Yeah.
And then on the other side, you have the card. Well, I also have on the other side another picture. My current deck is using the sleeves from Modern Masters, those gold and blue sleeves that look really fucking cool.
Yeah.
And are really easy to damage.
Yeah.
Those are in a sleeve protector with a heart border. So all my cards have their normal black border, and then on top of that is a red heart border.
Oh, okay.
And then my Abzan deck, it's sitting in these circuit sleeves that are just the stick-ons, so they also shred.
Mm-hmm.
And those basically, I've got five different sleeves in there because I'm a little crazy. My removal spells say no. My really good cards like Siege Rhino and Crackling Doom say on the bottom, this is a good card.
Yeah.
All my lands have Grumpy Cat over in the bottom corner. I've got creatures that are my really big creatures. They've got barbed wire border.
Okay, you may have to tweet a picture of some of these, because it's like, they sound amazing, like.
They are fucking amazing. They're sleeve protectors, again. Like, so, and they're not any better than your normal shitty sleeves, so they split. But the thing about them is my sleeves aren't the ones splitting. It's my sleeve protectors. I just buy more sleeve protectors, and my sleeves,
and then I have to worry about,
don't get damaged. Because those Magic Modern Masters sleeves, mm-hmm, I can't replace those.
Yeah.
They need to stay in really fucking good condition. And it serves the dual purpose, I guess, because they're double-sleeved my cards.
Yeah.
But no, I'm double-sleeved my sleeves, not my cards. And for the same exact reason, I do piles, because I don't, and I hate it when people fucking pick up my deck and start putting the cards in. You know what I mean? What do you call that? Fanning them?
Fanning them, yeah.
Oh, that makes me so mad. Don't fucking do that to my cards.
Why are you doing that to my cards? You're not going to like my answer then.
Oh, don't fucking touch my deck. Just pick it up and cut it. And don't fuck with my, they fuck my sleeves up. Like, seriously, don't fuck up my sleeves.
Yeah, it's like, you're definitely not going to like my answer then. My answer is I do double sleeve, but I probably would not double sleeve my standard deck if it wasn't for the fact that right now a lot of the cards in my standard decks are actually being used in my Modern and Legacy decks, specifically, mm-hmm, the Fetchlands. So I do double sleeve all three of my decks right now. Usually, I have a very exact thing that I try to do while I'm in the middle of a game. And this may just be me getting used to playing the competitive REL rules enforcement level and stuff like that. When I start off right before game one, I will power shuffle just one time, just to it's not so much to shuffle, it's more of to make sure I have 60 cards in my deck, that I'm not presenting an illegal deck and get in trouble,
That's
for
my
an
boyfriend
imprisonment.
says the only reason to pile shuffle is to count your cards. That's
Yeah.
how I shuffle.
It's like, and that's fine. I've seen people do that too. That's not a problem. But then usually even after I do that, I'll usually fan shuffle my own cards a little bit. Now, what the difference is comes in is the next step as to whether I'm playing just at my store or if I'm playing in a competitive REL event. If I'm playing at the store, normally I will just cut the other person's deck. I don't care enough about, if you're trying to cheat at that level, so be it. I don't care, sort of thing. I'll just cut it and be like, here, yeah, just go. And but say like I'm playing in a PPTQ or a Grand Prix or something like that, then I'm absolutely picking up my opponent's deck and I'm shuffling it. And I think it's honestly the expectation on both sides that I expect the other person to pick up my deck and shuffle it too, just to for consistency sake. So that's one of the things is, yeah, once you get to the playing routinely on that competitive REL level,
Never say
you
anything about it. It irritates me.
right,
I
yeah,
don't
no.
want you to shuffle my cards.
I would say, I mean, if someone walked up and they were coughing, hacking, I could tell clearly that they're not feeling well. Maybe they have the flu or something like that. Then I'd be like, you know what? Just don't. Let's just call a judge over, have him shuffle it, because I don't want to get sick from
Oh, that's another thing, is I get
whatever,
sick so easy.
whatever you have. But as like in general, I don't think I've ever actually run into that situation. So, but power shuffle. No, the thing that actually gets me is bridge shuffling. Like if you're treating your cards like this is just a deck of cards, like normal casino style playing cards, and you bridge shuffle, it's like that's the thing that bothers me. I'm gonna say again, standard, I probably don't care as much, but if I was playing Legacy with $200, $300 dual lands and a whole bunch of other stuff, and then you want to bridge shuffle my deck, like no, no. And I don't even know how vintage people do it. It's like you have to probably wear gloves to shuffle their decks, because it's just like you're dealing with $1,000 cards in there. So, but usually I'll fan shuffle though. It's like after I initially just count to, and I think actually I saw a video somewhere. It was on YouTube. I don't know what, but. It was someone who, it was a statistician who said, what's the best way to randomize a deck of cards? Now, he was doing it for, of course, casino cards, playing cards, stuff like that. Not for magic cards. But he basically said, power shuffling does not randomize it enough. They said, bridge shuffling a card, of course, is the best, but I've already discussed why I don't like bridge shuffling. But fanning, which is sort of like bridge shuffling, but it's more like a vertical bridge shuffle, essentially. Is it can do it just as well, and so that's kind of why I like to do the fan stuff when I'm shuffling my deck. So, in other words, yes, I double sleeve and I both power shuffle at the beginning of the game, and will and actually in between games two and games three, I'll also just fan shuffle. I will not power shuffle again, unless for some reason, like if I drew like almost all the lands in my deck or something like that. But even right now with fetch lands, even that's not the case. So, but if I was truly concerned about a land clump or something like that, then I would do it. But it's not that random that you actually, it's not that often you see that big of an issue, so.
Nope. All right, moving on.
All right. So, our next Ask AWC question is from this handsome gentleman by the name of Force Will MTG. I don't know who that is.
Stranger.
Stranger. How do you feel about top eight pins on people's playmats? Now, actually, the reason that I asked this question was because on Friday I had a very interesting conversation, or I should say I didn't. I saw a very interesting conversation with a couple of Magic pros, specifically Ari Lax and Ben Weinberg, who were talking about PTQ pins on people's playmats. But this goes to like invitational qualifier pins on people's play mats and stuff like that. Ari like started off the conversation. Top three. I remember PTQ pin mats being a sign of deep Levine trenching. I'll be honest, I have no clue as to what that term actually means. But he did say high correlation to post-match tilt-offs. Then Ben Weinberg chimed in after him and said, I never feared a PPTQ playmat. I always wanted to play them because I knew generally they haven't broken through yet, in parentheses, won a PPTQ, and tend to be super nervous when playing for top eight or in top eight. And then Ari likes talking to Sam Stodd, which I think is another one of the pros. He said, we had a group of bucket of pins for this purpose. They try to pull the cocky pin mat. When we win the match, we dump the bucket.
Now, I've
Which.
only played a couple of these, but I've seen a whole bunch, and every time I went up against them, they would always be really mad when I won.
Right. It's like, yeah, it's like, well, yeah, it's like, I have to agree with Ari Lax on this. The people that I have seen have the biggest tilt-offs post-match are people who have the top eight pins. That being said, I actually have my three invitational qualifier top eight pins on my play mat.
Oh my God. Okay, so that's gonna be with my main opinion on this. You're ruining your play mat. Stop that.
Well, see, here's the thing though. I would say normally in my store, I normally don't pull it out unless, you know, it's say like a PPTQ at my store or something like that. Because my store
Ruining your
actually
play
has
mat.
play mats that actually cover the entire
Table.
table, yeah. So normally I don't even worry about pulling out my play mat. It's like I'll just play with what I have here. But when I go to a PPTQ, I mean, is it a huge mental advantage? No. But I mean, I have had people who've asked me, it's like, you know, where'd you get those pins from playing? You know, it's like, oh yeah, one, you know, some top eight, some invitational qualifiers, stuff like that. When I was living on the East Coast. And I said, oh, that's cool, that's cool. And I mean, and it's a very small psychological game, and it's not a psychological game that even works all the time, but it is something that makes some things like a little bit. It's like, all right, you know, especially once they see that I'm playing a blue control deck. If I leave mana open, I've seen people just be like, pass the turn back. I've been holding two lands in hand, so it's just like,
Well, yeah, but that's just a player. That's
yeah.
not.
And so it's like I don't see anything wrong with it. I will agree, as I said, I agree with RLS's first statement that there is a kind of a high correlation because these are people who think they are really good at the game. And I'll be honest, even though I have IQ pins on my play mat, I don't think I'm good at this game. I think I am probably average to maybe slightly above average at this game. But I don't think I'm good. And I definitely don't think I'm great at this game yet. So it's not necessarily me saying it's like, you know, oh, you know, look at all my accomplishments. It's like because it's three invitational qualifiers. It's not even, I mean, it's not even a PPTQ. The best I've done in a PPQ is make like fifth place. And there was a one that had so few people that they only cut the top four, so I didn't even make the top four. It's like,
All I gotta say is you're ruining your playmat.
well, see, but the thing though is also that you also get play mats all the time.
You're
Like,
ruining your playmat!
it's like right now I have it in my Delver Insectile Aberration flip play mat from Grand Prix SeaTac. It's fine. Now
No, you're ruining your playmat. It is not fine. Every time I've seen one of these fucking things, they've got those pins up in the corner, and that corner is all kinds of jank that you can never fix. It's ruined.
I was like, well, what I may do is the next time I get a new play mat, I may not put the pins in there. And I'll have like a PPTQ play mat and a non-PPTQ play mat. So that way I don't have to.
Man, it's not even like the holes you punch in the mat, because those actually you can hide pretty well. It's just you watch it and it does the wave, and
Yeah.
then it starts to pinch, and the really long ones, it's fraying
What,
right
what, what?
around there. And I'm
Wait,
just like, oh my God, take better care of your shit.
how many pins was in that play mat?
Four.
Four?
Four.
Okay. I've never had that problem. Mine rolls up very nicely. It pulls out very nicely. You know, I've never had that issue with my
I've
play
seen
mat.
it in every play. The max has been four, and down here. But I've seen it in every fucking play mat that has those stupid little pins in them. It just
Okay.
makes me crazy.
Okay, so, all right, so
I'm like,
outside
get
of.
a lanyard, wear your fucking lanyard, and put it on your lanyard.
Is like, okay, so outside of the just destroying your playmat argument, so
I don't give
how
a
do you.
shit. Do whatever the fuck you want. Stop destroying your own property. That's my issue. I don't give a
Okay,
shit
all
what
right.
people do. Ser
So,
okay, listen. I'm the kind of player, I don't give a shit what you're doing. I'm paying attention to what deck you're playing, and that's it. You put down a card. Now, in my head's going, okay, so these are your options. You have only so many options. You have this much mana open. You have only so many fucking options. I
right,
don't
yeah.
care what you're doing. I don't care about your PTQ pins. I don't give a shit, you know, how what sis place we're sitting at the tables. I don't give a shit if you're slow playing. I'm doing my own fucking thing. I don't give a shit what you are doing.
Right. It's like.
Like, do whatever the fuck you want to do. If I feel you're doing something shady, I'm just gonna call a judge. 'Cause I'm playing my deck against your deck. You yourself as a person are not in the equation.
Sure. And it's like, yeah, absolutely, yeah. No, I agree with that. It's like, and that's the thing is, I personally don't care about it. As I said, it was just I saw the conversation. I saw a lot of people jumping on the yeah, the pins and the playmat thing is stupid. Why would people do that? As I, and I and what's bad is I understand your reason why you don't like it better than their reasons they don't like it. Like it's like because I understand that yes, you want to take care of your playmats and everything else. And so I understand that. Now, admittedly, if you have a bunch of them, that's one thing. But if you have a bunch of playmats, that's one thing. But I
Got six playmats. Take care of them. They're nice. Every single one you pick up, you got a story with it. It's your shit that you go play Magic with. Keep it nice. Don't make it jank.
Well, see, the thing is, I have playmats that I just won in raffles at my local store. I literally, and they're terrible playmats. I mean, just god
Okay,
awful
well,
playmats.
then
It's
go fuck
like,
up one of those.
okay, all right. So I have the approval to fuck up that one, but not the Grand Prix playmat from
No! Don't
SeaTac.
fuck up your nice shit. Well, I don't understand people. I really don't. I was like, he had this really nice, the one I remember that was the worst because it was clear he's never played with another playmat. Not because he can't afford a playmat because he's playing a $700 deck. No, because he's just never bought another fucking playmat. And
Right.
it's champions from some PTQ. I don't even fucking care. But it was really nice. You know, it had one of those really nice pictures of some of the planeswalkers and they were doing shit. And I was like, I really like that playmat. How do I get one? And he told me I couldn't, but in not directly that I couldn't, but essentially I couldn't. And I was very sad. And then I'm looking and I'm staring at this playmat because I also don't look at the opponent. I look at their mat the whole
Yeah.
game. And I'm like, you've beat this mat to shit. This was such a nice playmat. It is warping. It is the edging is fraying. This like the black's not black anymore. Take your care of your fucking shit, man. Like, holy God.
I'm gonna say, well, see, and what's interesting is that they had an issue with the pins. But not the playmats. And what I mean by that is a lot of times when you top eight some of these things, they also give you a playmat that says top eight on it. Or
Yeah.
champion or something like that. They
Yeah.
didn't have a problem. They didn't have a problem with the playmat itself, is with the pins. And so that was the even more curious thing for me was like, all right, so you
It's
don't.
it really these guys sound like a bunch of pros who don't like it when people are proud of how they fucking, you know,
Yeah.
play. The only comment I thought made actual sense was the one that says was the one sentence, I'm sorry, that's high correlation to poor match tilt-offs, and I think that's just a pro player being like, he's analyzing his opponent.
Yeah.
There's most of the people I play with these fucking pins tilt.
Yeah.
Now, that doesn't mean they all tilt, but most of them tilt, which, you know, whatever. Who fucking cares? We had an episode about tilting. Do your own thing, man. Chill the fuck out.
Yeah. It was like, yeah, no. And I mean, it's fine. And I can even understand the reason why there's that correlation because you felt like you've had some measure of success. And so when you lose or when you don't play well or you're not playing your best, then
Nah.
yeah, it's there. I understand the reasoning behind it. It's like, but I think
Well, this is a lot like in... I know Magic players hate this, and I don't give a shit. I'm gonna relate this to video games and World of Warcraft. There's a lot of the really high-end gamers, the ones who play in the raid groups who, you know, they compete for top 500 in the world, top 10 in the world.
Yeah.
Those guys act exactly the same way. Oh, you're wearing your cute little title? Well, look at this dragon I got from beating this fucking one boss.
Yeah.
Look at you. You think you're so cool? Well, guess what? I'm so better. And that's what this whole conversation sounds like to me. Look at you. You think you're cute. But hey, fuck off. I'm so much better. Look, all these buttons I'm going to dump on your match. See? I'm so much better. That's what this sounds like to me.
A little bit. I agree with that. But I'm with you. Just do what you want to do. If you have an issue...
Stop fucking up your playmat. Buy a goddamn lanyard. Put it on the lanyard.
It's like, so, all right, so, okay, so I think that's all we have for Ask AWC.
Yeah, that's way more than anybody needed to listen to. We're going to get right to the shit we did this week in Magic.
Magic the Gathering. Get the cards, play the game. Hope to win. But as we all know, it's not about winning.
Draft.
Commander.
Trading.
Legacy.
Modern.
Standard.
Tilt.
Table flip.
This Week in Magic starts now.
Alright, Will, what have you been up to?
Well, let's see. Besides doing some streams, which I have found out that when I'm not sitting in front of an actual opponent, I gratuitously curse at Magic Online. Not necessarily at the program itself, but people that I'm playing. For example, I was playing in Pauper League, this guy was playing blue-black. I was assuming he was like some sort of Delver, Gurmag, Angler type of deck in Pauper. And he was nothing. He was literally just capsizing my lands the entire time. And I was playing Tron, so capsizing my lands is actually a pretty damn good thing to do. But he had no actual win condition. His win condition was to time me out.
Oh, that's shitty.
I have nothing. He literally played no spell in the entire game besides capsize. I'm just like, what is he trying to do to me? He's trying to kill me here. Like, am I supposed to, is he going to just get to the point where he can start doing it two times per turn and then, you know, I have to start discarding my lands at the end of turn or something? I don't know what his plan was, but I think I was gratuitously cursing during that one. I did a Modern League last night. Out of the five Modern League matches, four were Eldrazi, and I did win one of the Eldrazi ones. So even with a budget Modern deck, you can beat the Eldrazi deck, especially if you're just playing blue-white affinity, essentially.
Well, that's good to know.
Yep. And so beyond that, I did a couple PPTQs. I want to start off with the PPTQ from last weekend real quick, because I had an interesting situation happen in round four, and I had to make a judge call on this one. And I'll be honest, I do not agree with how the judge handled it, and I took it to Twitter afterwards to ask them what they thought. But here's what happened. Round four, I was playing against a guy who was playing what I essentially think was Mardu tokens. I'm not 100% certain, though. It may have been like Mardu control. But anyway, he had a Gideon on the field, and one of his lands was a Shambling Vent. So he activates a Shambling Vent, moves it forward, he taps it, says swinging, then backs out because he remembered that he forgot to activate his Gideon to swing as well. Plus it. At that point, I call the judge and be like, judge, like, because I was trying to make the argument, we're in combat, and when you're in combat phase, you can't activate your planeswalker. You can do it in your second main phase, but he never said combat, and the only thing he said was swinging, and that's what I tried to push to the judge. And the judge said, oh no, okay, we're going to back it up. He's still in first main phase. He can activate his Gideon. I'm like, really? Really? He said the word swinging, and that's not attacking? You say swinging, that's not declaring attackers?
Yeah,
so I ended up losing that match. And I honestly felt... I didn't know if I was just being sort of scummy, just making that call. Because I was just like...
No, he fucked up. I think that the judge made the bad call.
Yeah, that's and see, that's what I think too. But and more I think about it, it's like, was I just trying to be a rules lawyer saying, you know, oh, well, you said swing, so obviously you're in the attacking step now. But people on Twitter seemed to support my point of view and said, you know, yeah, that was a bad call. That should have been. But unfortunately, because of the PPTU, there's no one to really appeal to, so.
Yeah.
Have to kind of roll with that one. I ended up losing that match. Going 2-2, which leads me to my second story of how I conceded my way out of the chance of a top 8. It was a 5-round event. I was at 2-2 in the going into the 5th round. I was currently sitting in 10th place. We had like 20 some odd people there, something like that. So, and I also had the best breakers. I was the highest of the 6 points.
Wow.
Because, you know, you get 3 points per. So, I had the best breakers and everything else. Currently sitting in 10th place. Everybody who was in 8th place or higher going into the last round already had 9 points.
Okay.
And so, I was like, okay, well, if they all intentionally draw, then there's no way I'm making it into the top 8. Like, because if they draw, they all have 10 points. If I win my match, I only go to 9.
Mm-hmm.
And so, I'm still short. The guy that I was facing, who was the 9th place person, had 10 points. Sorry, he had 8 points already. He was 2-0-2.
Okay.
And so at that point, I was like, okay, you know what? I can't get in. I might as well concede the match to you because, you know, there's no chance for me to get in. Well, the thing I didn't take into account is one of the top 4 tables decided to play, actually, because they knew one guy could jump them and take one of their spots.
Oh.
So what happened is that if I would have won my match, because I had the best breakers, probably of everybody in the tournament at that point, if I would have won, I would have, if I would have played the match and won, I would have gotten into top 8 of the PPTQ. So that's
lesson learned?
Lesson learned is like, yeah, I am terrible with breaker math. Believe it or not, this is not the first time that conceded my way out of a top 8. Whether it was an invitational qualifier or a PPTQ.
Then I think the lesson you should have learned last time is stop doing that.
Well, see, that's what I thought too. But, you know, it's... I'm terrible at breaker math. That's all I can say.
Then don't
do the
math. Just play the game.
Sure. And that might be the best thing. Just play the game. And if it happens, it happens. So
yeah. If the worst comes to worst, you're right.
As like, but the PPTQ and standard, the PPTQ was standard. And actually, I was very happy with the way my deck was playing, even in the game. And I only had one game where I honestly felt like the mana got to me and I wasn't doing well with it. So, so I decided to run it back this next weekend at the PPTQ about an hour or so away. And this was the last chance PPTQ. For in other words, on Sunday they have the regional Pro Tour qualifiers,
mm-hmm.
but always on the Saturday before they always hold a last chance PPTQ. So if you win that, then you get to go back the next day to actually play in the regional.
Oh.
So there was about 60 some odd people there
mm-hmm.
Yesterday. Ended up going 1-2-1, and I was playing like shit. This was not deck. This was all me. Including in the match that I drew, I had a Jace emblem on the battlefield,
mm-hmm.
and I missed like 4 of my triggers to have the opponent mill. And I was just like, oh my gosh. And so I had to do something at the end of that match or end of that game to actually win that game, which was a little extreme, but I was at 3 life and the only 2 cards in my hand were, Painful Truce.
Mm-hmm.
And Silumgar Scorn.
Okay.
And so, and I had nothing on the field, but the opponent only had 6 cards in his library. So I was like, all right, I'm going to cast Painful Truce for 3, which would technically kill me if it resolved. Have you mill, then hold priority, cast Silumgar Scorn, have you mill. So now his library has nothing, and then I just choose not to pay the 1 mana, so that way the spell doesn't resolve and I die. And then I passed the turn, and he lost on draw step because he had no cards to draw. But that shouldn't have gotten to that point. It should have been over a lot sooner than that.
Yeah, probably.
So that was completely my mistake on that one. But and then it took so long to win game 1. By the time game 2 and game 3, game 2 he won like with 2 minutes left to spare, and there was no way either one of our decks were gonna get through game 3. So, yeah, I mean that was just sort of. a glimpse into what I was doing this past weekend, and I was just playing like shit. It was like, it was just bad. So basically, in all this, the main point is, come watch our Twitch stream if you want to see me gratuitously curse during Magic. Because you can't do it during the middle of the game. You can't say, you know, if an actual person is sitting across from you, you can't say, like, oh, that's some fucking bullshit. You know, you can't say that.
Well, you can.
All right. In competitive REL, you cannot say that. It's like, if you're playing in an actual event, you cannot sit across from someone and be like, oh, that's just fucking bullshit. Like,
oh, no, Magic, I totally do that.
But on Magic... But on Magic Online, you could do that all the time, and it's not a big issue. So, if you...
I'd be like, hey, that's a fucking bullshit top deck. Fucking lose. Good job.
I must say, I have said that before. I've said, specifically, I think I was playing someone who was playing Ensnaring Bridge in their modern deck. And so, I Vendetta click in their draw step, take the Ensnaring Bridge that was in their hand, have them put it on the bottom, and then they get to draw for Vendilion Click. Well, guess what they drew for Vendilion Click? When he tapped the 3 mana, I was like, are you shitting me? Like, this really happened? Like, seriously? Did you just draw the Ensnaring Bridge on the top? He's like, yep. Like, ugh. Like, no. No. So, needless to say, I lost that game. But it was just like, are you kidding me? I played this game perfectly. It was just like, like... That's how I lose this? Like, anyway. So, yeah. So, basically, yeah. That's... We're currently sitting at 4 subscribers on the Twitch stream. So, it's actually doing better than I thought at this point. I'd like to get a few more. But, so...
Well, I played some Standard and some Sealed. My Sealed was pretty bad. And it's my own fault. I started feeling really sick right as we started opening the cards.
Mm-hmm.
The Asian food I had for dinner did not sit well.
Ooh.
So I put together this shitty green-white deck. And, I mean, it wasn't terrible. I had really good green cards, and I had really good white cards. The problem with the deck was, which when I started feeling better, I fixed it. So the first game I lost because it just was not fast enough. It had really good cards, but it just wasn't, you know...
Yeah.
Stable. I had to wait too long to get shit moving.
Yeah.
And... So I lost the first game. Totally my fault. Next 3 games, I fixed it. I put in the good blue I had, which I had some really good blue control. The one drop, awaken, bounce it back to your hand, shit like that. And all that just, it stabilized me. Now, okay, you might be coming in faster. Well, I got this shit, you know. You don't have it anymore. It's dead now. Stuff like that. And so 3 games, 2, 3, and 4, I went 2-0. That's how, 2-0. So that was good. Standard, I really love my deck. I do. But I need a lot more practice with it. The land base confuses the shit out of me. And it's just because I haven't practiced it enough. I haven't gone to Standard enough because I've been playing so much Sealed. And it's just, I've got all these tap lands, and all these fetches, and all the fucking pain lands, and I just get really confused, because it's 4 colors.
Yeah.
What do I need? What might I draw? What do I need to put down? What do I need to, do I need to use my fetch to go get a tango, or do I need to get my fetch to go get a basic land? What do I want to play? What might I want to play?
It's like,
my land base is so confusing.
Yeah, it really is. It's like, I mean, thankfully, since I'm playing Esper Dragons in Standard, it's a lot easier because normally the answer is fetch land into blue battle land.
Yeah.
Tapped. Then second turn is fetch land. They can go get a blue mana, so that have Silumgar scored up. Essentially,
and that would
at
be
that point.
Super easy if, you know, I wasn't looking at, like, do I need to use this fetch land to go get a basic land so I can play this tango untapped on turn 3? Or do I want to play the tango on turn 1 so it's untapped and then I can play other stuff and get to turn 3 and play this card? Or do I want to play it tapped here so I play the fetch land on turn 2 so I go get a basic land and then on turn 3 I play another basic land so on turn 4 I play another tango land?
Yeah, it's like...
So
it's
turn
confusing.
1, I'm losing my mind.
It's confusing. It's very confusing. So, I sympathize.
And it's so. It's just because it's four colors. If I was running three colors, it really wouldn't be that big of a deal.
It's like, well, I mean, well, good news is, I mean, Shadows over Innistrad is just around the corner, and, you know.
That's not good news. Fetchlands go away. I need to master this land base before we move on. Because it should not be this crazy every time I pick up. I lost one game. Admittedly, it was against Red Deck Wins, and he had me by turn three. Okay.
Yeah,
but I lost that game because I pulled the wrong land.
Yeah.
And I couldn't Crackling Doom on turn three.
That's the tough thing. See, that's the very tough thing, is that it's... This is a format where picking the wrong land can literally cost you the game, depending on, you know, on where it is. It's like, that is the toughest thing about this standard.
He hit me for 18 damage on turn three. What was I supposed to do?
Well, all right, so admittedly, against a Tarkir Red that can combo you out like that, it's like...
Yeah, turn three, I was dead. I was like, oh my god, and it's all my fault, because he only had one fucking creature.
Yeah, it was like, so then how did he fill up his graveyard with just one creature?
He's pull off Red Deck Wins. He's not playing a Tarkir Red.
Oh, okay, all right, sorry, Tarka, sorry.
Whatever. No, Red Deck Wins. It's some combo with Double Strike and Titan Strength and... Abbott, I think.
Yeah, all right, yep. Okay, all right, now I know what you're talking about. It's like...
It's my fault. It was literally my fault. The immediate game before it, he had tried the exact same thing, and I pulled my land right, so I hit him with Abzanchar when he did all that shit. I was like, okay, Exile.
Yeah.
And he was like, well, balls. And I was like, yeah, Siege Rhino, I win.
Yep. It's like, good luck getting through the Siege Rhino.
And the next game was, I needed to Crackling Doom, send it back to his hand, and next turn, Siege Rhino, I win.
Yep.
But I pulled my land wrong. And I looked at my land and I went, this is land for Abzan Charm. What the fuck were you thinking? Mm-hmm. And there was no answer for that. I was just being stupid. So... Anyways, alright, so let's get to some actual topics instead of listening to us bitch about the silly things we do. We're going to talk first about, at least Will's going to talk a little bit about this, because I really don't give a shit. Eldrazi is continuing to dominate Modern.
Go ahead and throw a slash on that, and per Legacy as well.
Really?
Okay, maybe not dominating, but currently the Star City Games, as we're recording this, the Open in Philadelphia for Star City Games is Legacy. The number one played deck on day two. Now, admittedly, it's only 9 copies versus the whatever 30-some-odd copies that was in the Modern the week before. But still, the most played deck in day two of the Legacy Open? Eldrazi. Colorless Eldrazi. Because on top of all the broken lands that we talked about last episode, you get on top of that, you get Ancient Tomb and City of Traitors, both which also tap for 2 mana at a time. So you have, you know, 16 lands that do really broken shit in Legacy.
Yeah.
So, but this one's more specifically talking about the Modern results last week. Out of the top 32 decks for the event of the Modern Open, only 7 were not either Affinity or Eldrazi.
Yeah, yeah. And that's out of how many decks?
Out of 32.
Sam.
So basically, 25 of the decks were either Affinity or Eldrazi. Everything else were Affinity or Eldrazi. The other things were, specifically, I'm going to just go through real quick. Kiki Kord with Jeff Hoogland, but Jeff Hoogland's been practicing that deck for a while, and I'm not even shocked he made the top 8 of this thing. It's like, but he's the only one who put up results with Kiki Kord. Then you have Merfolk, which a lot of people are saying is very good against the Eldrazi deck because it plays 4 main deck Spreading Seas.
Mm-hmm.
9 through 16 are all Tron, or sorry, all Eldrazi or Affinity, even though there is one little particular deck I want to talk in there that. Then you go from 17 to 24, you have a Jund deck, you have a Scapeshift deck, and Blue Moon. And Blue Moon's another one of the decks that's supposed to be really good against the deck because it plays main deck Blood Moons. that's supposed to help shut off all the stupid stuff the temples and lands are doing. Mm-hmm. And then you go 25 to 36, and you have a red deck and a blue-white control deck. So it's like, so yeah, so literally only seven decks that were not Affinity or Eldrazi. However, and it was sort of funny that all weekend long that Star City was calling it the Eldrazi Winter, which is not, that's actually not a term that they should be using, you know, mm-hmm. for this, because even as insane as these results are, this is not even close to what Combo Winter was, which was the only emergency banning that WotC ever did in a format. And that was for a memory jar, and it was things that, you know, if you lost the roll, you lost the game. Like, they would go off turn one. You would never get the chance to play a land in Modern, which is something that's what they had to emergency ban. WotC's already come out on Twitter and said no emergency bans for this deck. This is not happening. It's like, this is just gonna be, you know, we're just let it go, which is why at the beginning I say, how long is it till Shadows over Innistrad? Because Eldrazi is everywhere. And not only that, but Eldrazi is everywhere on Magic Online. As I said last night when I did the My Modern League, four of the five decks that I played, 80% of the decks in the league that I played were Eldrazi decks. Like, and I was playing a budget Affinity deck, not even the good Affinity deck. That was what the fifth person was playing, and they kicked my ass. So WotC said no emergency bannings. However, there is one deck that I did want to highlight real quick. Mm-hmm. And this is the deck that scares me. Out of all the Eldrazi decks, it's the ninth place deck by Zach Voss. So this is the kind of, all right, how can we make the Eldrazi deck even more insane? Oh, let's just play the Urza lands behind it as well. It's Eldrazi Tron. So not only do you have the quick starts of the Eldrazi Mimics, Endless Ones, Reality Smashers, Oblivion Sowers, and Thoughtknot Seers, but then you also play the Tron lands, which allow you to ramp up to Kozilek and Ulamog. Like, I saw that deck and I'm like, are you shitting me? Like, seriously? This is a deck now? Like, are they actually trying to combine the crazy Eldrazi Temple Eye of Ugin deck with the Urza's deck? And so help me God, if I actually had enough Eldrazi Temples and Eye of Ugin's, I would build this deck. Because this deck looks amazing. It's like, just like, okay, so I get to play the fast aggro game of the Eldrazi decks while also having the ability to play the long game and put out Ulamog. Like, I'm surprised he didn't throw an Embrakul somewhere in here, just because why the hell not? Like, I mean... Well, I'm at a loss at this point. I personally think something from this deck will be banned in Shadows over Innistrad. I don't know what, but something will be banned.
Yeah.
My guess is probably either. And originally I said I thought Eye of Ugin might be the problem, but I actually had some discussions with people on Twitter this week. They actually opened up my eyes a little bit mm-hmm. on this. I actually think you have to ban both of them. You can't leave one or the other. Like, if you ban Eldrazi Temple. Mm-hmm. Then you still have the quick openings from Eye of Ugin that you can play like three creatures on turn one.
That's true.
If you ban Eye of Ugin and keep Eldrazi Temple, then all they do is just play four Vesuvas, which says when it comes in the battlefield, it comes in tap, but it copies target land. So, you know, you have Eldrazi Temple and you have Vesuva that you can copy the Eldrazi Temple with. So it's not really solving the problem at all. So I think the answer is when it gets banned, you have to ban both of them. Now, I have
Whisper
heard
Whisper seems to agree with you.
Yeah. Now, I have seen some people say, well, should we just ban Eldrazi Mimic? And I'm like, well, first of all, WotC's not going to do that. Eldrazi Mimic just came out in their latest set. They're not going to ban that right after it came out. But
well, no, they might.
I mean, they can, but I don't see
They can
see
do whatever
it.
The fuck they want.
Well, they can, yes, but I don't think Eldrazi Mimic is the problem, though.
That's true. I don't either.
I think the lands are the problem, so... Yeah. That's why I think the lands would be the first things to go. But anyway, so yeah, it's not as bad as Eldrazi Winter as what they're calling it. And there is a Grand Prix in Detroit next weekend that is also Modern. And this is the one that all the pros will be attending, so we'll actually be able to see if they have come up to an answer with against the Eldrazi. My guess is probably not. My guess is that they'll probably kind of do what they did here on the Star City thing and just start diversifying which Eldrazi decks you're playing versus, you know, whether it's blue, white, green, red, Bant, colorless, just the, sort of the mono black version. So that's kind of where I think we're headed, but they're all basically all centered around that those two lands. So, but my guess is, yeah, chances are it's definitely not going to get an emergency ban. It's probably not going to be banned until Shadows over Innistrad. Now, the interesting thing is, will they ban anything from the Legacy version? My inclination watching it this past weekend is no. Because only 9 people are playing it in a 64-person day 2. So that's not the same percentages that it was last weekend. So my guess is they're probably not going to touch the lands in Legacy. But if pros start really trying to focus that Legacy deck a little bit more, I can see it happening. So, but anyway, so yeah, Eldrazi dominance in Modern continues. I actually played against the Eldrazi deck yesterday at the PPTQ that was basically blue-green-red teamer, something like that. But it played just a bunch of pain lands for their colorless mana sword.
Yeah, I think that's brilliant that the pain lands work so well and they get so much light, more use thanks to Eldrazi. So I don't like how... I don't even fucking play the format, but I don't like any format that gets dominated by a deck. Yeah. So it's, on the one hand, it's really disappointing that they can't keep going, because they really can't fucking keep going. This can't stand.
No,
and then they can't, and on the other hand, the pain lands are just like, but we finally saw really good use. People love us.
Well, the good news is they're not going anywhere in standard.
Well,
so
they're
not
going anywhere, but that's not my point.
Yeah.
So, all right, moving on. Next, we're going to talk about Conspiracy. Yay, yeah. Conspiracy.
I'm about to say, they announced Conspiracy 2, and they did a week-long, they literally did a week-long event to kind of hype this set up.
I'm so fucking excited for this. The words, they won't even come out of my mouth. I'm so excited. I don't think I'm going to be able to play these in stores because the stores I go to don't really do this kind of fucking thing, but I don't even care because I'm just going to buy a box and we're going to have a party on the weekend and we're going to draft Conspiracy and it's going to be so amazing. Oh my God. I love
that sounds
Conspiracy.
Great. Yes. It's like, so they announced Conspiracy 2. Now, when they announced it last Monday, they announced it as Conspiracy 2, The Reign of Brago. And so then on Tuesday, what they did was they released a photo of, and I don't even know how the hell this is possible, but they announced they released a photo of Brago getting stabbed by a knife. Now, if you remember, Brago is a spirit. So I don't know how a spirit is being killed, but apparently this person did something. This assassin. I don't know. So apparently Brago's dead. So on Wednesday, they renamed Conspiracy 2 The Empty Throne. And what they actually did was the original card count that they had on the website was 221. They scratched through it and put 220 to show that Brago died. And then...
Wow.
And then on Thursday, they released another image saying more things are incoming about this, you know, and wait for an update on Friday. Then on Friday, they announced Conspiracy 2, Take the Crown. And this, I think, is their final version of it, because one, they finally gave us a set icon, mm-hmm. which basically looks like a crown, essentially. As if you're staring down on a crown, essentially. But mm-hmm. Then they also put the cards back up to 221, which it originally was. But the other thing is they released a new image that shows Marchesa, the Black Rose from the original Conspiracy, now sitting on the throne in the plane.
Yeah, and she's awesome.
Yeah, she's awesome. So,
and that's the image if you're watching on YouTube. That's what you're looking at right now.
Right, yeah. And so, apparently this is going to be conspiracy. Let's just call it what it really is. It's Conspiracy Game of Thrones.
Yeah.
It's like,
and nobody's got a problem with that.
No, it's like, no. And I think that's going to be awesome because, I mean, Hey, look, the whole entire Innistrad set was essentially based off of Twilight. So, you know, why not base something a set off of something that's actually pretty cool in Game of Thrones and
Yeah.
to take the crown? Like, that's like, yeah, no, I'm excited about this for two reasons. One is, again, chances are, if they did what they did with the first conspiracy, they'll put some nice little legacy and vintage playable cards in the set. Because from the first set, that's where we had Counselor's Judgment, which was the one of the few answers to True Name Nemesis in Legacy, because the way that it was worded. And then you had Dak Faden as a Planeswalker in there as well. So I don't know if this means we'll get a reprint of Dak Faden or we'll get a new Walker. My guess is we'll get a new Walker out of this.
We need a new walker. I mean, as much as I need that Dak Faden for my Planeswalker collector set, I fucking just want a new fucking walker. Seriously, it's past time.
Yep. And so, yeah, so that's kind of what I'm thinking we're going to, I think it's gonna be a new Walker. It's like, because I can't imagine them just releasing Dak Faden, the same Dak Faden again, 2 years after, you know, the first one came out. So,
Oh, I can.
I mean, it can, but
I mean, the
I'm,
card is a bit expensive.
well, I mean, the non-foil version is what, $30,
Yeah, exactly.
and the foil version is like $300.
And they're really hard to find.
They are, yeah,
So,
because.
you know, you can keep a bit of the price by giving it new art.
Yep.
So it's not the original. It's not the original art. You know, that you don't. You continue to print the foil, but, you know, with the new art, so the old one keeps its value, people are happy, and then the rest of the people who are fucking poor can get their hands on one.
So, and it's like, and they've already announced it's gonna be the set will be in August of 2016.
Oh,
Which
wow.
is going to make for a very expensive and busy summer for Magic.
That's what I was about to say. Jesus Christ, when's Enchanted Masters coming out?
Eternal
Eternal Masters?
Masters is coming out June 17th of 2016.
Oh,
Eldritch Moon,
jeez.
the second half of Shadows Over Innistrad, comes out July 22nd, 2016, and Conspiracy 2 comes out in August of 26th of 2016. So literally, we're going to be getting a set a month during the summer.
That's irritating.
Yeah, a little bit. It was like, it's interesting. I think I know why they're trying to do it, but it doesn't make a lot of sense in the long run because one, we're putting two things that are going to have legacy and vintage playable cards in about a 2 month time frame. So, like, all right, so what's going to be, because like the original Conspiracy had Brainstorm, Stifle, Exploration. These are all cards that could easily be in Eternal Masters.
Yeah.
As well, it's like, I mean, you could easily put Brainstorm, Exploration, and Stifle in Eternal Master. So what's going to be a Conspiracy 2 is either going to be something new, which will be awesome, or you know, it's just going to be reprints of other things that we may have even gotten in Eternal Masters already. Like,
We'll see, I guess. I mean, what else are we gonna do?
I don't know. I do not know. So, but
Well, I'm
and
looking
then.
forward to the spoilers. I will say that.
I
It's gonna
am too.
be an interesting spoiler season.
I am too. And then late September, I should go ahead. Let's go ahead and throw this in there. Whatever the fall Magic set is, the new
Oh,
block,
yeah.
and late September will be that. So it's
Well,
like we'll have
start
four.
saving your pennies, kiddos.
Yep. It's like now the good thing is they already have said the conspiracy packs are going to be just traditional package price, which is $4. You can actually find boxes of conspiracy still for like $80, I think, the original conspiracy.
Yeah,
So.
they're still really good to draft. You
Yeah.
don't spend that much to go pick up a box.
Yep. And so, yeah. So this will be definitely very good to kind of pick up, and I think it will hold its value pretty well if it's anything like the first conspiracy. So.
Hopefully. I mean, some
So.
of those conspiracy cards are worth quite a bit of money.
Yeah, they are. They
So,
absolutely are. So.
good luck, guys, with your saving money and shit, because
Yeah.
I don't even know right now. I'm just sitting here. The boyfriend wants 2 to 3 boxes of Eternal Masters. That's
Yep,
like
that's
$900.
probably, yeah. Well, I was gonna say some probably $750 for suggested retail, but we don't know what stores are gonna be charging yet, so
Yeah, about $900.└================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================�================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================�================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================�================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================
Yeah.
And then I'm going to want to play the new conspiracy, and then I have to somehow keep up with standard.
Yep.
Jesus. I don't think we're getting 3 boxes. I don't give a shit what he wants. I don't think that's going to happen.
Maybe do like 1 and 1 or something like that. And if you,
I think I can swing 2 boxes.
2 boxes of
Tron Master? Probably find some place will give me a deal on buying 2 boxes.
Probably, yeah.
And then move on from there to the rest of the shit we need to do. Oh, to sidetrack everybody. Sorry, guys. I was meaning to ask, are there any standard decks right now running combos?
Technically. No, it's like, I mean, I guess it depends on what you consider a combo. Like technically a Tarka Red is a combo. It is you pump it up with Becomements, then you do Team or Battle Rage, so you swing over for, you know, it's technically a 2-card combo that can do like 15 damage, but it's not.
That's true.
There is also talk of using Eldrazi. You have to have this is a 3-card combo from what I've heard.
Okay.
But it's Eldrazi Displacer, Zillaport Cutthroat, and let's see, it was one of the green.
Oh, what am I even thinking about? Is Broodmother?
Brood Monitor.
Yeah, that one where you put her in, she drops 3 colorless. You
yeah.
put in the other dude, and he bounces her if you pay 3 colorless. So you just keep doing that.
Yeah, and you just
how do
and
you
and
win?
Yeah, yeah, basically what you do is, well, Eldrazi Displacer says 2 and a colorless. Creature you control, exile target creature, return to the battlefield tap. Well, it doesn't matter if it's tapped or not, because you can just keep doing Brew Monitor, and each time it comes in, it keeps getting 3 to pay the cost. Uh-huh. And if you have Zillaport Cutthroat, then you're getting 3 damage every time you sacrifice it.
That's what it is. Okay, yeah.
It's like, and so it's just an infinite damage combo, essentially, that you can do that with. So, I mean, those are kind of the 2 big, quote-unquote, combos, but neither one sees... I mean, a Tarka Red sees play... This Eldrazi Displacer combo does not really, but.
Well, no, it's one of my friends is saying it. He's down in, he's at GP Houston.
Yep.
And that's the deck he plays.
Is Eldrazi Displacer?
Yeah. The thing about standard is most standard placers don't know how to combo deck.
Yeah, it's like, it's an awkward combo deck at that. It's like.
Well, they still don't know how to combo deck.
Yeah.
Awkward or not, most standard players do not know how to combo deck.
No, it's really like, no.
And what irritates me about that is then most standard players are also very judgmental of people who play combo decks, because since they can't play it, that combo deck is just janky shit.
Yeah, it's like...
It's very irritating for me.
It is. It's like, yeah, it's kind of a... As I guess I'm, since I play Modern and Legacy, I'm used to combos. Like,
and it's not janky shit.
It's not janky shit. I mean, hell, I've gone back to playing combo in Modern. It's like I'm playing Jeskai control combo with Resto Angel and Kiki Jiki.
I mean, you remember Prophet of Krufix and Villainous Wealth?
Yep.
People were like, oh, that's just janky shit. You have to just get lucky. I was like, no, that's a hard deck to play. If you can't play it, it means you suck at this game.
Yeah, no, it's like, yeah, no, it's, combo decks are their own thing. It's like, I mean, I think people, I mean, are they seeing people who thought that Splinter Twin was janky? I mean.
Yes.
They thought Splinter, okay, see, all right, then that's like where I completely disagree with them. It's like.
That's what I'm saying, is they'd be like, well, I don't understand Splinter Twin. That deck is too complicated, and I don't think it's very good. And then they look at the Villainous Wealth Prophet of Krufix deck, and they'd be like, oh, that deck's just janky. It just takes luck to play. It doesn't take any skill. I'm like sitting here going, you can't play the deck doesn't make it bad.
Yeah, no. No, and Splinter Twin, I mean, hell, it got banned because it was so, you know, universal. It's like, well, not universal, but they didn't want, you know...
Yeah, I know what you're saying.
I'm
just bitching now. I've got us completely off topic. I put up a technical difficulties sign because we're not even on topic. We're just talking about shit.
No, that's fine. It's like, yeah, no, I think it takes different type of players to play combo decks. And as I said, I mean, even...
Some combo players, that's all they can play.
Right.
Because that's where their brain works. But combo decks are not jank just because you can't play them.
No, there are some very, I mean, once you get to the Legacy side, good God, you have Storm, you have lands that's technically a combo deck, you know, you have I mean, you just have a whole bunch of different combos.
I see this mentality is mainly with standard players. It's not with people who play modern, and it's not with people who play legacy. It's because you have so few combo decks in standard, and they don't understand how they work, and they don't understand how combos work, that they pick up the deck, and they're like, oh, this is just jank.
I'm going to say...
Like, holy shit, guys.
I mean, there's only one actual combo deck that's probably been in standard in the past, like... year that has gotten any press whatsoever, and it was the Jeskai Ascendancy deck.
They thought that deck was jank too.
It's like, and no, see, and that's the thing, is it really wasn't. It's like, it was actually pretty decent, especially when you had Summon Carry added that can't even be targeted, you know, you couldn't get rid of it. So it's like, I mean, it was never, I don't think it was ever the best deck, but it was still a legitimate deck. It's like, and then you had the Teamer Ascendancy combo, which I actually liked that one for a bit because of the, you know, you just produce, you know, essentially, you know, infinite amount of mana, and you just, you know, start drawing your deck and put anything on there and be like, all right, swing, kill you. but that was like a 4-card combo to make it work. So that was a little excessive, but... The good thing about that deck was it was also a pretty decent just green devotion deck that just happened to be splashing red and blue in it. So
five color rhino, wasn't that a combo deck? You had to get that.
Not really. No, that's just giving you.
Okay, I should preface all this. I know I'm bad at combo decks.
I was like, well,
let's just say that I can't even identify a combo deck.
The five color rhino deck was just having all the ways to tutor. Rhinos, or make copies of the rhinos, it was just basically how many rhinos can we throw into this deck?
A million rhinos.
Yeah. So, not really a combo deck, but it was definitely an interesting deck. It's also one of the funniest videos. If you go look up the rhino song on YouTube.
Oh my God, rhino, siege rhino, no.
So.
Oh, not siege rhino. It's like, rhino.
Yeah, rhino needs to, I'll be happy when rhino goes away, so.
Yeah.
But, alright, so, our next piece of news, just really quickly, I think this is going to be our last piece of news, honestly, the May 2015 FNM promo came out.
And it's Goblin. Yes, it did.
And it's Goblin Warchief, which is interesting because it's not, Goblin Warchief's not in standard right now.
Well, it's not the first time they've done that. So if you don't know, Goblin Warchief is one colorless, two red. It's a 2/2 Goblin Warrior. And it says, Goblin spells you cast cost one less to cast. Goblin creatures you control have haste. Now, I'm going to try and get my hands on this because I played Goblins in EDH.
Uh-huh.
So I don't own one of these. This card's like $20.
Yep. So it's like, it's a good card. It's a good card to reprint.
Yeah, it is. I'm really pleased with this promo. I need to get my hands on one.
But it's making me wonder, because, I mean, like, last year they did, the only non-standard promos they did was Path to Exile and Serum Visions, and that was right after the release of Modern Masters. So, I'm sort of thinking either, A, does this mean Goblin Warchief will be in Shadows Over Innistrad, which I could see it.
That wouldn't be a bad reprint. Nope.
It wouldn't be a bad reprint. Or if it's going to be in either, like, the Eternal Masters or the
Conspiracy
or something like that down the road as well. So, I given that it's the May promo, I think if it's going to be in anything, it may be in Shadows Over Innistrad, but I wouldn't be surprised if it's... and sometimes, you know, I actually prefer them... I would rather them do these all day long of cards that people actually want versus the shit that they have been printing out, like Clash of Wills,
When they did Path of Exile.
Yeah, that was awesome.
That was a great reprint. And it's not like they fucking reprinted it in a set. They just gave us it as a promo 1 month.
Right, yeah.
They need to do shit like that. And these cards are worth so much more money when they do it that way.
Yeah. I mean, these are the things that get people into Friday Night Magic. Is like, I mean, I don't know about your store, but, I mean, my store just changed our FNM nights to modern because... People are not showing up to play standard right now because who gives a shit about Clash of Wills?
No, we don't have that problem. People, I go to places where we play to play the game. We don't play.
Well, I mean, I'm not playing for promos, but it just seems like the attendance on at least the standard events that we were doing. We're doing good to get like six people on standard night. For Friday Night
Okay,
Magic.
yeah, we don't have that problem. We've always got, okay, we have the second biggest comic book store in the nation here in Dallas, and it's got something like 100, 200 people Fridays.
Okay.
And then that's every Friday.
Oh, wow. Okay, now that's just impressive. It's like,
and yeah. Then the comic book store I go to more often because I don't like that crowd, we get 20 people every night, every Friday.
Okay, so that's good. It's like, yeah, because, I mean, when we did Modern Friday Night Magic this past week, we had, like, 12, 13, something like that. Mm-hmm. So we had a much better crowd than what we've been getting for Standard. And so,
yeah,
I think,
and 20 is a bad night at my main store. 20 is a bad night. On a good night, there's so many people, Sealed has to go into the other room.
Right.
Because there's no room for us at the Standard table.
So,
but I also live in fucking Dallas. So
true. It's like, I mean, I bet if I went to, you know, if I was living closer to Seattle or something like that, and went to like Mock's Boarding House or something like that for Friday Night Magic, it'd probably be a much larger crowd than what we have here. So
exactly, yeah. I think that's just an area thing. I don't think you need to think that's the what's in the air.
And it's like, well, there's actually two stores in the area, and I think, like, I may go check out Standard Friday Night Magic at the other store.
If nothing else, that's the way you trade. That's the only reason I ever go to Madness. If you're only at one store, even a store as big as Madness,
right?
You eventually run out of people to trade with. Everybody's seen your stuff, nobody wants what you have.
Yep.
And you can have a binder with hundreds of dollars of cards in it, nobody wants it. You have to go to a new store. Go there, they'll probably want your shit because you're bringing in all these cards that haven't been in circulation.
Right.
So if once your trade pool gets stagnant, go to a new store, do a whole bunch of trades, change up your binder, go back to your old store, and you'll start moving stuff again.
Yep.
So that's why, it's the only reason I ever go to Madness is trades.
So, and it's like, yeah, I will probably, I think we go see, because I really prefer to play like each format like once, maybe twice per week or something like that at most, just to kind of stay sharp on what's going on, make sure I'm playing with the deck and everything else. So, So I think that I probably will try that next Friday night. I will say the one thing my main store has started doing now is they have started their own Twitch stream. So that they actually broadcast live. Actually, if you go back to the Friday night this past week, you can see what I did against the Mill deck, which I honestly, if this was not Friday Night Magic, I would never, ever recommend to do what I did, but I did it. It's like, I lost game one, of course, because my deck doesn't win fast enough to beat a Mill deck. It just doesn't. Because it's a control deck. It's a control slash combo deck, but my combo is turn five. Just not fast enough. So game two, what I did was I said, okay, I sideboard in, and I have Ley Lines of Sanctity in my sideboard.
Uh-huh.
I brought, of course, all three of those in. And I was like, all right, you know what? I'm going to be on the draw. Now, it doesn't make a lot of sense because, all right, a deck that's trying to mill me, why would I want to draw an additional card to make it easier for them to do that? But I did it for two reasons. One, I knew I was probably going to have to just mulligan until I hit the...
the combo in your hand.
Until I hit the ley line in my hand. Hit the ley line, because then he can't target me with the mill effects. It'd be like... And so he can't target... If he can't target me and I have it in my hand on the first turn, I just put it into play for free. That's how the ley lines work. So I was like, all right, well, I'll draw seven. Don't have it in there. And I'm like, draw six. Okay, I was like, all right, six, I can probably... Yeah. I looked at it, I was like, it's close. I could probably do this, but it didn't have the ley line in it. But I was like, you know what? Nope, mulligan. Go down to five.
Uh-huh.
And I had the ley line in there. But I only had one island and one mountain in the hand otherwise. I was like, okay, well, I have it. I guess I got to keep this hand. But I knew I was going to be drawing whatever the top card was at least. So I was like, all right, if it's a land, I'll keep it on top and it should be okay. I don't think it was a land, so I put it on the bottom. But I was like, okay, and then I said, all right, I'm ready to go turn zero, ley line of sanctity. And my opponent's face just dropped. Like, okay, like, I have no answer for that. So it took a while for me to actually end up winning the game, but I did because he just couldn't target me with his the milling effects. It's just like, so as I said, never... Don't ever mulligan just to get to a certain piece, unless it's just absolutely vital to do it. But that was one case where it actually worked. And it's Dark Tower Games. It's the Twitch stream. And you can go check it out on their past broadcast. And it was something else. And what's bad is the two matches, I started off because basically whoever's table one is on the feature match, the mm-hmm. camera match. So I started off on table one, won that match. Round two, still at table one. That was the middle opponent that I faced off against. Mm-hmm. And round three, unfortunately, my first round opponent lost, so that moved me down to table two. And then from that point, I proceeded to lose the next two and miss out on the top four. No, not like this. The first two games were so awesomely played, and then it's just like, nope. So, but anyway.
Oh, well. All right. So, well, that's going to be it for us here at Alternate Win Condition. We're happy that you are back listening to us. I bet you're happy we're back to making episodes.
Yes, absolutely. Yep.
All right, so if you'd like to hear from us during the rest of the week, you can find me at Janaelle5, Janaelle, and the number 5. You can find the show at AWC Podcast, and you can find Will at...
Force of Will MTG. You can also find... you can also email us at awcpodcast@gmail.com. That is our email. You can also go on to our website, awcpodcast.com. Which, actually, I did a little editing to this past week because I was able to actually put the Twitch stream on the website itself. Cool. So, if you can go to the website, and if I'm broadcasting live, it will be there. Actually, I probably should be directing people to that versus doing it directly to the Twitch channel. But, anyway, we do have a Twitch channel as well. You can come and hear me gratuitously curse. twitch.tv/AWC podcast is definitely R-rated, just... kind of let you know that.
That's not our rating. That's like
PG-13. PG-13. All right. So, yeah. I guess it's not that bad cursing. Yeah. So, it's a PG-13 rating. But it is a lot of cursing. And then you can also find the show on SoundCloud, on Stitcher, YouTube, MTGcast. Am I forgetting anything? iTunes.
Stuff. We're on everything. So whatever you're listening to right now, comment, thumbs up, star, 5-star review, whatever. Share it. Just get it out there. Get it into other people's ears because we want to be talking into all your ears.
Yes.
Because we're creepy. No, we're not. We're not creepy.
We want to whisper sweet nothings of
cursing. No, we're not cursing. Creepy. Stop. No, we're not creepy. All right. So we will be back just next time, whenever the fuck that is. Go check out the website. The website's awesome. We put all sorts of effort into the fucking website.
Yes.
So
absolutely.
Check it out, and we will talk to you again later. Bye.
Bye.